Welcome everybody to Lecture 2, Information Retrieval in the Winter Semester 2017-2018. So, experiences with the first exercise sheet, which was about the inverted index, and some good news, there's no lecture next week, thanks to Martin Luther, who is celebrating his 500th anniversary downstairs somewhere. So the contents for today is a ranking and evaluation. So we will learn all about this, and also the exercise sheet is about this. It's a small competition, so you implement some ranking for your simple search engine from the first lecture, and then you tune it, and then you try to get results as good as possible. And then there will be a table on the wiki where you can put your results. And I will show you some standard things which everybody should do, and some advanced tricks with which you can play around, and whatever you can think of. There's a question.
If next week is no lecture,
yeah?
Will you have time 2 weeks for the exercise?
The question is, will you have time? How much time will you have for the exercise sheet? Let's look at the... Oh, it says Pfad noch not gefunden. The sheet is not yet there? Okay, the sheet is not yet there. Yes, you have 2 weeks. And I will. It's written on the... You have 2 weeks for the sheet. But of course, you should start right after the lecture. Don't wait for 1 week. It's always a bad idea. It's called procrastination. So experiences with exercise sheet one. So of course, for some of you, it took some time to get started, like SVN, Linux, and some of you were out of programming practice or never had programming practice, a few. Yeah, but this will get better very soon. The task itself was deliberately easy and also nice. So quite a few of you were in the mood to implement some extra features. Here are two suggestions. One was to use Git instead of SVN. We get that every time. I mean, we are using SVN Git internally at our in our group, but Git has no access control, which is very important for a course like this, right? You should not be able to see the repositories of the other students. So that's a bit hard. That's not what Git is made for. It's open source, and here it's not open source development for all of you together, for each of you separately. We are always thinking about how to make it possible with Git, but it's not so easy. Somebody's asked about terminal recording, so I'm not sure why would terminal recording be useful. Is that person here who is yeah, what would be the advantage? You're talking about like Vim.
The usage of Vim, seeing you how you are using Vim.
Yeah, but in the video recording, you mean you see what happens, but you don't see which keys I was typing. Okay, just ask when you see me doing some, because I'm just using like 5 or 6 standard things. You should just ask, and then I will be happy to tell you. And I think, yeah, here is my configuration file for Vim, right? It's linked on the wiki. So it says about some editors, Vim, including here, and here it's this configuration file. You can just download it, and it has some of this special configuration. So that's already there. Okay, why is it called inverted index? I forgot to say that. So if you think about it, the movies data set which we provided is listed by a record or document. For each record, it gives you all the words. What does an inverted index do? For each word, it gives you all the records, documents, which contain that word. So in that sense, it's an inverse representation of the data, right? All the words for each record, all the records for each word. That's why it's called inverted. So here are some, yeah, some queries that worked well. I just took some from your experiences, TXT. So James Bond worked well. Why? Because the keywords are sufficiently specific, right? Even without ranking, you get all the James Bond movies, because Bond by itself is already specific, and so on. Of course, if you have a super specific keyword, that's apparently the name of the movie, it also works, because there's only one document containing that word. Here's some examples of things which didn't work well. You all made that experiences. Numbers were not indexed. Yeah, and these all hint at the many things which you have to do right if you want to have a search engine that works well. We all know search engines which don't work well on the web, like intranet search engines, and those are some reasons, right? If the thing you're searching for is not in the data, you don't find it. You type a space and there's none in the data sets, you don't find it. There's a typo, if you don't have error correction, which we'll do later, you don't find it. And ranking was an issue, right? You have a lot of films mentioning the word redemption, and the number one redemption movie comes relatively late in the list, so you don't get it as number one hit. Here's one very important piece of advice. Despite my hint on one of the slides, several of you managed to implement the construction in quadratic time. How did you do it? You didn't do it deliberately, but you did it nonetheless. You wrote something like this, right? Very innocent looking code. So you just went through your file, you have a new record ID, you append it to the end of the inverted list of the, right? This is like the obvious code how to do it. I want to append it, but only if it's not already in the list. So if not already in the list, append it. So what's wrong with it? Yeah, I mean, then the index construction takes very long, and then you say it takes very long because it's a big data set. Yeah, it was not so big. It was just 200,000. The problem is checking whether something is in an array. It doesn't take constant time, right? I mean, it could be done in constant time because the only place where this element could be is at the end, so you could have just checked, is it at the end? But you are just calling an internal routine which doesn't know how this array here is sorted, right? So it will just search the whole thing linearly, and it does that every time. And you should know that if you do something linear for a growing array, this takes quadratic time, right? It's 1 plus 2 plus 3 and so on. So this is a super common mistake, and it's maybe the single most important piece of advice for your whole study here in computer science, that you should never do that, right? Just using built-in functions and thinking, well, they are built-in, they must be efficient, right? Yeah, I mean, it's reasonably efficient if you don't know anything about the list, right? But so this is really very common also, I think, in code from companies and whatever. You really should pay attention to this. So I gave the advice, and still many of you did it. Okay, that's feedback about the first exercise sheet. Any questions about this? Otherwise, I will proceed. Okay, I will proceed. So today we talk about ranking. It's of course super important. You saw that with your simple search engine, which didn't do ranking queries. Yeah, just one slide of motivation, right? Often you get many hits, and typically more than you can even look at, right? For web search, millions of documents. But even for your simple search engine, it's important, right? You have something in mind, you want it on top, and not number 7, like Shawshank Redemption, right? So we want to have the most relevant hits first. And now the big problem is, and we are talking about nothing else today, how to measure what is relevant, right? And that's it's kind of a fuzzy concept. Think about it. You have to guess sort of what the user had in mind when he or she was searching. And now you have to figure out what's relevant to that search intent. So here's how you operationalize it. So in the inverted list, and that's what you will do for the exercise sheet, these are our inverted lists. So the word university, for example, you have some documents containing university. Last time we had astronaut. It's contained in document or record 17, 53, 97, 127. And now in addition, we also have a score, which somehow says how important is university in document number 17. We will see in a second how we figure that out. Maybe it's just mentioned in passing, or here the document really is about university. So that's, yeah, and here it's kind of not so important for the document. Here, this would be the query University Freiburg. We can do the same things for other words, right? And now, when we merge the two lists, we can... Yeah, today we will merge, and also for the exercise sheet, you will change your intersect to merge, which means you will compute the union of the two lists. You can just aggregate these scores. So if you have 17 and just one of the two lists, you will just take the score from that list. If you have something like 53, which is in both lists, you just add it up, right? So let me just write this here, that here, aggregation is a sum. Here, sum. Right? Other aggregations are thinkable too, but here we just do sum, and that's also very common, right? So we just merge these, we sum the score if the document is contained in more than one list, yeah, and then we sort it, right? And now we get 127 first. Why? Because it's in both lists and has a high score in both lists. That's why we get it first. But note, we do not necessarily now get all documents first which occur in both lists, right? For example, 34 is only in the second list, but with a very high score. 53 is in both lists, but the sum of the scores is 0.3 smaller than 0.8. So actually 53 comes relatively late, right? So this is how you manage to get a mix of results where some contain all of the keywords, some contain only some of the keywords, right? And you just sort by this score. That's simple enough, right? So these entries are called postings, right? So this combination of these two numbers. Sometimes that's just a traditional name. Sometimes it also contains more information, like at which position did something occur in the document. You can use that for phrase search, words or proximity search. We don't do that here for now, right? Maybe one of the tricks you want to do for your next exercise sheet. Yeah, that's what I just said, position of a word. Any question about this? I think simple enough so far. So, getting the top K results. So actually, these lists can be very long in real search engines, and in a real search engine, we only want top 3, top 10, top whatever, right? But not all of them. So, you can do, and that's something you have to do for the exercise sheet as well, you can do a sort of the result list. If it contains n postings, entries, it's n log n, you know that. But you only need the top k, so you can do a partial sort. And a partial sort can be done in time n plus k times log k. Yeah. In case you didn't know that, now you know it, right? If you think about it, yeah. Why is it n plus k log k? Do you have any idea? Think about it for a second. Why? Yeah?
First iterate over the list one time, get the 10 highest elements, and then sort them in k log k time.
Okay, the suggestion was go over the list once, get the 10 highest elements, and then sort in k log k, where k is 10. How do you get the 10 highest elements? That's not so easy, right? Yeah? Yeah? Yeah, with a priority queue. That's a good idea. And then actually you don't have to sort them afterwards. So that's one way to do it, which is kind of what heap sort does, right? Heap sort works that way. The only thing is you have to construct your heap in linear time, but that's possible. If you just use insert in a priority queue, that would be n log n. But you can construct a heap in linear time, and then you can just give the delete min or delete max k times. You have another idea? Or? Yeah, so that's one way to do it. Another way to do it would also be quick sort, and you just only go into the recursion when you're in that part of the subarray, which is interesting, the top k. If you think about it, that also works in k log k. Think about quick sort, you're dividing the array in two halves, or almost two halves, and now you have the left part, which is the, let's say here, the bigger documents, and the right part. You're only interested in the left part. You don't have to do the recursion in the right part if it's to the right of k. So that way you also get k log k, right? Yeah, and for constant k, that's linear time, so in practice that's significant, yeah? You can ignore this, or if you are up to it, you can also implement this, right? Some languages also have a function for a partial sort. C++, for example, has a partial sort. Python probably not, because efficiency for Python is anyway, when it's so efficient, you don't need functions for efficiency. Meaningful scores. So, I've shown you the principle, you have scores for each of these inverted lists, and it's very important what these scores are, right? So how do we, yeah, that's the main issue, right? The idea was simple, how do we get good scores, like here? Yeah? I already said this. This should somehow, for this whole scheme to work, how important is Freiburg for document number 34? So here it's very important. How do I find out? So, yeah, the meaning, the semantics of this should be this document is kind of about Freiburg. Whereas in 53, Freiburg is only mentioned in passing. It's not document 53 is really about something else. How do I do this, right? Yeah, and of course, the larger the score. It's not important that these scores are normalized between 0 and 1. Sometimes they are, but for the scheme I showed you, that's not important. Right. Now, the problem is that something's subjective, right? And actually, you need a natural language understanding even, but yeah, it has to be done somehow anyway, and here we will do something very simple. So here are some ideas, and it will gradually get more complex, but overall will still remain relatively simple, basic mathematics. Term frequency, that's a very obvious signal, and it's actually a good one, right? How often does a word occur in a document? Is Freiburg mentioned 1 or 15 times? When it's mentioned 15 times, the document probably has something to do with Freiburg, right? So here I have a query, University of Freiburg. I've added of, you will see in a second why. Because there's some interesting to say about such words here. So in document 57, 5 times mentions university, 3 times Freiburg, 14 times off. So it's really about off this document, yeah? And this document is even more about off, yeah? So we'll see in a second. So if we would just do this approach from a few slides ago, we would just sum these up. 5 plus 14 plus 3 is 22, 2 plus 23 plus 1 is 26, yeah? And we would get this, which means in the final result, 123 would come before 57, right? Yeah, and what's the problem with off? I mean, off is a very common word. It doesn't really mean anything as off, if off is mentioned in a document, right? It shouldn't count so much. This 57, if you look at it from these numbers, looks like a better hit for University Freiburg because the two more important words are mentioned more often than here, right? So actually, I wouldn't still like 57 higher up. So how do I solve this? And many of you observed that already, right? If you enter these common words, somehow the search results become meaningless. You get results which contain a lot of and, the, of, and so on. So that's why you have document frequency. That's the second most important signal. That's the number of documents containing a particular word, right? So here, just for example, let's take the three words, University of and Freiburg. Let's assume they occur these number of times. You're a computer scientist, so you know what's special about these numbers. They are powers of two. For simplicity, you see in a second why. And now let's take the inverse of this, right? So I want a number which is smaller when these are high. So I take like 1 over df, yeah? And for reasons you will see in a second, I will take n over df and I will take the logarithm. And yeah, let's assume I have 1 million rounded to the next power of 2 documents in my collection. And then I would get these numbers, right? Why would I get these numbers? So this is 2 to the 20 and this is 2 to the what? 16? (clears throat) 1,000 is 2 to the 10. 14, yeah, I agree, it's 14. Yeah, 2 to the 16 is 65,000 something. So it's 2 to the 14, 2 to the 20 divided is 2 to the 6, right? So it's 20 minus 14 is 6, and I take the log 2, so I get 6, right? So you could have reverse engineered it from this number, right? So this is just half of 1 million, so 2 to the 20 divided by this is 2, log 2 of 2 is 1, which is why I get 1 here. Yeah, you see where the inverse comes from. This number, this should be low if this is high, and it works, right? So here, off is very frequent word contained in half of the document, so I get a very low value here. And Freiburg is somewhere in between, that's 2 to the 10, right? 2 to the 20 divided by 2 to the 10 is 2 to the 10, log 2 is 10. Okay, yeah? Why do we have the log 2? That's a very common trick. It's, yeah, otherwise small differences would have, I want small numbers here. You will see in a second why, because I want to put it together with term frequency. Yeah, the log 2, I want differences here, but I don't want differences in the millions, but small number differences. Yeah. So just look at this line again, and this now should reflect how common these words are. Yeah, Freiburg is... University is relatively, Freiburg is relatively specific in this collection, so it has a high number mentioned in not so many documents. Off is very unspecific, so has a low number. Okay, and now one way to combine the two is just multiplying them, right? Here's our example from before, and now, yeah, let's just, let me just copy the numbers from before. It's very simple, it will get a little more complicated in a... So IDF, this doesn't work, writing up here. IDF of university was 6, right? IDF of off was 1, and IDF of Freiburg was 10, right? So this was the most specific word. I pressed too hard. Ah, doesn't work. Why doesn't it work? Oh, now it works. Not so easy. I'm sorry, the pen is kind of broken. So, yeah, this is the TF-only example from before, 123 at the highest score, and now we combine it. So, 5 times 6, right? Everything here we multiply with 6, because IDF University was 6. So we get 5 times 6 is 30, 2 times 6 is 12. Everything here we multiply by 1, which means nothing changes. Everything in here we multiply by 10, so we get 30 and 10. And you have to do this in code, and that's actually, you have to think about it a little bit, how to do it efficiently. I think I have a slide with some advice in a second, right? And if I sum up these numbers, now I get 74 and 45, and now 57 has the highest score, right? And this, I think, conveys very well the intuition behind this, yeah? Now, university and Freiburg occurrences are boosted, and how often off occurs is not really important. Any questions so far? Okay, simple enough. So what are problems in practice? So now we refine this a little bit more. This is a good formula and it's used really a lot, yeah, wherever people deal with text, in whatever research area, this TF-IDF, you will see it everywhere, but it has a few problems and we will deal with these now, yeah? The IDF part is usually used as it is, but the TF part has some problems. Here are 3 problems, and then I have a few slides how to address them. So let's assume we have 2 documents, and one is longer than the other, right? I mean, if you have a document which is twice as long, then it's natural that it contains words more frequently, right? Just because it's twice longer, it will contain everything a bit more often. You should somehow account for that, right? Now assume you have 2 documents of the same length and a word is more frequent in one than in the other. So if it's twice more frequent, doesn't necessarily mean it's twice more important, right? Maybe it's significant, it's a bit more significant, but the factor of 2 is a bit, yeah? Too extreme, you want to dampen this somehow. So that's what you do. So here's BM25 formula. Yeah, this some research group, they tried out a lot of formula, and the 25th formula they tried out gave the best results, and this became famous from then on, because for 10 years they won all the text retrieval competitions. Yeah, so this is a really famous formula, although it's very simple, and I will explain it to you now. It's like TF-IDF, this is the IDF part, which remains unchanged, but the TF part, we modify it, and we modify it like this, so drum roll, that's the formula, yeah, it's and you will see, yeah, that's a weird formula, right, so it's TF times blah blah, I have some K here, I have some B here, DL and AVDL, they are easy to understand, that's just the document length and the average document length, and then I have some tuning factors, K and B, and for some mysterious reasons, these numbers, yeah, these default settings often work well, we will shed some light on it in a second. But let's first understand the formula, right? But before we understand it, it has one nice property. It contains two standard settings as special cases. Let's just do the math here. I mean, that's kind of a sanity check for the formula. Let's just plug in, so there are these two tuning parameters, K and B. Let's plug in K equals zero and B equals zero. Let me also give a name to this factor here, that's often called alpha. So if B is zero, then this big factor alpha is what? It's one, right? Yeah, if B is zero, this is just one, right? So this is kind of a factor between zero and one. So alpha is one, which means my TF star is now TF times, let me write this like this, K plus 1 divided by, and it's now K plus TF, yeah? K plus TF, okay, that's divide by TF in the denominator and the numerator. So let me just write this as divide by TF here and by TF here. So that's K plus 1 divided by K divided by TF plus 1. Oh, actually, K is zero, right? I could have just plugged it in right away. Yeah, I think K is zero, so I can just plug it in right away. So that's TF1 divided by TF, right? It's just TF divided by TF, so it's just one, right? So whatever my actual TF is in that formula, it becomes one, yeah? So that's a binary setting, right? This is what you did for the exercise sheet. No matter how often the word occurs, you just added the word once to the inverted list. So this is the other extreme, K equals infinity, let's do that. So B is equal to zero, then again, this alpha factor, it doesn't play a role here. Alpha is equal to one. And now I need what I just wrote. I want to see how this behaves when I let K go to infinity. So let me, you tell me when I make a mistake. So I just, this is just a formula where I put alpha equals to 1. TF. Yeah, I want to know how this behaves when K goes to infinity. Let me divide by K above and below. This will help me. So it's just 1 plus 1 over k. And here it's 1 plus tf over k. Yeah? So if k goes to infinity, this becomes 0 and this becomes 0, and then it's just tf. Yeah? And this is just 1. Yeah, so these are my two border cases, 1 and TF, right? So they're, yeah, and if I choose parameters in between, I get something in between or a little bit different. Okay, now why that formula? Why this very famous formula? You can read tons of papers with theory about it, but I like theory, but I don't believe in this theory. You will see in a second why. Here's a simpler explanation. So to me, you want TF has some problems, and I had a slide about which problems I think it has. So here's some nice properties. You want to replace it by something with the following properties. This something, if the word does not occur, that something should also be zero. That's natural, right? If the word occurs more often, it should be, yeah, the score should be higher, right? So this TF star should increase with TF. And when the word occurs really frequent, this should not rise above some threshold, right? That's also natural. So you have some fixed limit which this is approaching. Yeah, and my claim is, it's obvious that, now we will prove that it has these properties, but given that this has these properties, it's the simplest formula which you can come up with. And let's just prove this. So let's just write this a little different now. We are now looking at TF, how this behaves when TF changes. So let me write this a little bit different, and then let's check whether these properties hold. So let me write this as TF times K plus 1 divided by, and you have to implement this for the exercise, plus TF. I want to know how this behaves when TF changes. Now I have TF above and below. That's a little complicated. So let me just divide by TF above and below. So this gives me K plus 1 here. And K over TF plus 1 below, right? Okay, now let's... If TF is equal to zero, okay, for that I don't need the... So is this true? Yeah, I think that's... So TF times, let's first prove this, K plus 1 divided by K plus TF. When is this equal to 0? Well, for this to be 0, TF has to be 0, right? Because this here is never 0. I think that's, easy. TF star increases as... Let me just write it like I've written it here below. K plus 1 divided by K over TF plus 1. Yeah, well, I have TF, so it's inverted here, and then it's at the bottom of this fraction, so it's inverted twice. So as TF becomes larger, this whole thing becomes larger, right? So this is also true. You can see it here. And now let's look at the limit. TF star, let me also write it that way again, K plus 1 divided by K over TF plus 1. And let's see what happens when TF goes to infinity. So the word occurs really often in my collection. Yeah, since I have it only once here, so this part becomes 0 now, right? K over TF becomes 0 plus 1, so becomes 1, it's just K plus 1, right? So it's also, yup. Any questions about this? Yeah, I think that's, it's just, and that's something you very often do for ranking functions. Actually, also in machine learning, yeah, you want functions with a certain property, and then Yeah, you can do some theory to prove that this is a good function, but you can also just do it this way. I want a function with certain properties, like these three properties, and then I just take the simplest function which has these properties, right? And this is it. So there was a little more. There was this alpha. Let's also explain this alpha. That's actually easy. Yeah, so far we have this here. I've just explained it to you. And now we want to normalize it by the length of the document. Well, normalization, one simple normalization is you just look at how long is the document compared to the average document from my collection. So if it's twice as long, I just divide it by two. Yeah? But that would be a bit too extreme. Yeah? If it's exactly the average document size, it's just one. I wouldn't do anything. So I do something in between, not normalizing at all, and full normalization by just taking this here. Yeah. So this would be the full normalization, and this would be like a factor of one. So, for example, for let's look at the two extremes. So for b equals zero, we already had that; it would just be one. Right? So no normalization. Yeah? This would be no normalization. And for b equals 1, this would be dl over, yeah, this would be the full normalization, right? Normalization. Okay. Yeah, so that's what I do. I just, this factor B just gives me a slider to say, do I want no normalization or full normalization? And we saw it, I think this standard value was, yes, 0.75, so pretty strong normalization, but not full. Right? So now you just plug this in here, you just divide by alpha, and then you get this formula, which actually, because I divide the TF by alpha, I have this here and here, and so I can just simplify this to this formula. And that's how you get the formula from three slides ago, right? And the final BM25 score is then just this modified TF, which has all these properties, which I explained, times the unmodified IDF, yeah? As I already said, you can read, I have them in the references. There are lots of theoretical papers. I think it's a favorite research occupation of theoretical information retrieval researchers to provide some theory for why this is true, but I think this theory is no more convincing than these plausibility arguments. Are there any questions about this formula? No? Okay. So, now you have to implement this formula. So, wake up again if you somehow got distracted from this. You have to implement this formula here. How do you implement it? So, you have a TF part here, you have an IDF part, and you have these factors here, right? This is important for the, yeah? First, compute the TF scores. I mean, you can... It's actually interesting how to do this efficiently. TF, yeah, TF is something, yeah, did you do that? I think some of you did it, yeah? Was it part of the exercise sheet? No, right? We didn't. We already did that. Implicitly in lecture one, right? Because in lecture one, what we did, we just added a record ID to an inverted list as often as the word occurred, right? So if it was in a list, in a document five times, we added the ID five times. You changed this for the exercise sheet. So, yeah, and instead of adding it five times, you should just... add a counter, how often I have it there, right? While you're doing this, In this pass over the documents, you can easily compute the dead document length, right? You can measure document length via number of words or number of characters. It doesn't really make a difference if you think about it, because you're taking ratios to average document length. Yeah, and the ratio will be approximately the same whether you count number of words or number of characters, right? So now you have all the document length, you store them in an array, and you have all the term frequencies, how often each word occurs in each document. And now you make a second pass, and you can replace the TF by these real scores, right? And the only difficult part, so this is just, you have to just write it in code, right? It's a complicated formula, but it's easy to write down. You have all these numbers. How do you get this DF? IDF is just inverse proportional to the DF. DF is just the document frequency. How long, how many documents contain a word? And that's just the length of the inverted list. That's also something we did in the very first lecture, right? If you want the number of documents containing a word, it's just the length of the list which you have computed in the first pass. So, if you don't do it that way, it can become pretty complicated and also pretty inefficient. So, think about this. So, you should implement BM25 for the sheet. Maybe it's time to look at the, try to look at the sheet again now. Thanks to Claudius, it's there now. So this is the exercise sheet. Yeah, you just take your code from the first sheet and now you extend it, right? You shouldn't link to it, you should always copy stuff, right? So every exercise sheet should be self-contained. So what you should do, you have your method, which essentially I wrote for you in the first lecture, and you just modify it so that instead of binary scores, you have BM25 scores. You easily get TF, and I showed you how to get in a second pass the BM25 scores, right? You really have to pay attention to do this efficiently. Otherwise, this, yeah, if you do something quadratic, already for our little small collection, it can get very slow, especially in Python. You did intersect for the first sheet, you should do merge now, right? You should also include documents which only occur in some of the lists, yeah? If you implemented your intersect nicely and correctly, this will be a very small change in your code. And now your process query method should aggregate these scores, as I explained, right? The sorting, you can just use a built-in sort, but maybe you want to do an efficient partial sort, then you may want to implement it yourself, yeah? There's again a tip file and everything. Let me show you the tip file. Yeah, here's a tip file, and it contains again nice test cases. So most of the tip file is about the test cases, which is really to help you to get it right. So there's a small example file. Let me show you this as well. So Claudius did this for you. Thank you, Claudius. This is your example file, right? Example files for testing should always be short. Short says short here. Note that some words occur twice in a document. That's important so that you also find errors with your term frequency. So this has a term frequency, short has a term frequency of 2 in document number 4, right? Which you should see. Yeah, short has, right? So this is the kind of inverted lists you now get, yeah? Document number 4, line number 4, contains short and it contains it twice. So these are the normal TF scores, TF-IDF scores, so they are easy to understand. And here are BM25 scores, and they are weird, right? But and because it's so easy to make mistakes there, we gave you a few test cases. Okay, let me... Where's the... Yeah, exercise 1, let me come back to the sheet in a second. Now, okay, let me go to exercise 2. Now you have implemented vanilla BM25, And now you can just run it and see what results you get. Now you should get good results, right? And we will talk about a benchmarking in a second, but let me maybe show you the benchmark file already now. So this is one benchmark file we are giving you. It looks like this. We have some queries here, 10 queries actually. And we have what we have done for you, we have found in this 200,000 movie collection all the documents which are relevant for that query, right? This is how you do it in benchmarking. I have a number of slides for that in a second. So these are the relevant documents for films about spiders. These are the relevant documents for this long query, right? And now you can run your search engine and you can compute how close the result list comes to this. This is what the second part of the lecture is about, right? And we have 10 queries here. Here's a very deliberately one, romantic comedy, right? There are, of course, a lot of romantic comedy movies. It's a long list. This is to check that you did everything efficiently, right? If you did something inefficient, you will get problem with this list. So, and that's the only one which is very long, yeah? So, let's go back to the exercise sheet. Yeah. So what you should do for exercise sheet 2 is play around with the parameters of BM25 to get a good results on this set, which I've just shown you, right? And optionally, you don't have to do this, but that's what the next two slides are about. Try other improvements, right? You have these 10 queries now, and now you try to get the best results possible, right? Oh no, you shouldn't do it on this benchmark which I've just shown you. I think you should do it on your own queries. That's important. Yeah, let me I will come back to this in a second. The benchmark file is something which you will use in the end for exercise 3. So this tuning, I have a slide on this. This tuning, you will do it on your own queries, right? You try to tune your search engine as much as you can to get good results. And here are some further tricks which you can use, but you don't have to use. BM25 you have to use, this you can use, yeah? So play around with the parameters K and B, of course. Here are some ideas, and be creative, think about what can be done to improve ranking of your search engine, right? Ranking is a big topic. For example, if you have a result which contains all of the query words, maybe you should give it a bonus. Maybe not, right? Can also be a problem if you have stupid words which don't carry any meaning, right? And also, if you are too restrictive, you may miss some results, right? For example, Steven Spielberg movies, the movies word is not really important. Maybe you should include it, but you should give a bonus if it contains both Steven and Spielberg, because they are both important, right? Take the popularity into account, right? Maybe usually people are searching for popular things. You can, the file on the wiki does not explicitly give popularity scores, but it's sorted by popularity. So you can take the line number as a popularity scores. And popularity scores actually have a ZIPF distribution, which I've shown you in the first lecture. So you can take n to the minus alpha as popularity score for the nth movie in the list, right? You can take something like this. So these are just a few ideas. Think about what else you can do to improve your ranking. So that's exercise 2. Make your search engine as good as you can without looking at the benchmark file. I explained it wrong at first. Here are some advanced methods. You can also use them. It will take you a few weeks, so I guess you don't want to use those, but I want to mention them. They're very important for real search engines. So query logs, you probably don't have query logs for your own search engine. Yeah, but Google has it, for example. They know what users in the past have searched and what they have clicked on for certain queries. And of course, you can use that. And it's actually one of the main pillars for the quality of a search engine like Google. Machine learning is also very important. Yeah, you have these parameters like the K and the B. Now you can tweak them by hand, or you can use a machine learning algorithm to tweak those, right? This is something we will talk about later in the lecture. So second part of the lecture. Now you have implemented something, now you have tuned it, so that you have the feeling, now I have a great search engine with great parameter settings and great tricks. And now for exercise three, let me make this clear again. Now you evaluate your system on the benchmark, which I've just shown you, right? All the tuning, you do it without looking at the benchmark. You can look at it, but you don't actually compute the numbers. So now you evaluate it, and evaluate means you get a number in the end which says how good is it, yeah? Typically, or very often, just one number, like a grade, right? It's unfair, but that's how life is, right? So one number which says your search engine is 83% or 51% good, right? And 100 is the best. So how do you do that? That's a very important topic, right? Evaluation. So first you need a ground truth, and I've shown you a file with ground truth, which you will use for the exercise sheet, yeah? So, for example, Matrix movies, these four documents are relevant, right? So this, whenever you do a research in AR, that's part of the job. Actually, also when you do research in machine learning, it's the same thing. Yeah, you need something to learn from, something to test on. So some input and what's the correct output. So this would be the perfect result, these four, right? So this we have given to you. You don't have to do it yourself because it's a lot of work. Now, how do we evaluate? Here are some measures, and I will start with the very simple measures and then gradually some more interesting measures. Precision, so precision, and now we just do a lot of examples. I think these are best understood by example. Precision is just at a certain position, how many of the results are relevant until that position. And let's just do this here. So here I have four relevant documents. And let me just indicate what's relevant here. So five, my top hit is relevant. Yeah? Let me just indicate this here. This is relevant. And 17 is not relevant, not relevant. This is relevant. And 10 is relevant. And then somewhere here, 877, it's somehow down here, yeah? My 877 is, I should have it in blue here. It's somewhere down my list, right? So this is my document number one, my document number two, my document number three, and my result list, 4, 5, 6. I don't know yet what I will put here. And the others are not relevant, right? This is the typical result list. Some relevant ones, hopefully at the top, and some not relevant ones. Not relevant at number two. That's of course not so great, but that's how it is. So, precision at one. Yeah, I will do precision at one for you, and then you tell me what's precision at two, and so on. Precision at one, I just look at the top result and how many of those are relevant. So all of them are relevant. So it's 1/1, and it's 100%. What's precision at two? How many results of the first two are relevant? I want a number. Huh? 1/2, yeah. It's 1/2, right? So that's 50%. Yeah? So precision at K is really simple. P at 3, precision at 3? 1/3, yeah? So that's 33%. Precision at 4? Yeah, it's 2/4, so it's 1/2. That's 50%. So you see, precision at is not a monotone measure, right? It can go up again. Precision at 5 is what? 3/5, which is 60%, right? Okay, so, and this actually, yeah, somewhere down here, it doesn't really matter, right? It's really, I'm looking at the top hits, so this is one of the measures for a web search. You don't really care what's further down, you care what's in my top 10 or even top 3 or even top 1. This is also a very important measure, right? Is my top hit relevant? Because it's really annoying if it's not, and also disturbing. Or so there's also a measure P at R, which is just P at the position where the position is the number of relevant documents. So here I have 1, 2, 3, 4 relevant documents. So this here would be my P at R, right? My P at R would be the P at 4, yeah? I'm just, because why is this a meaningful position? If all my relevant documents were at the top, then at P at 4 I would have 100%, right? So it's possible to get 100% for P at R. So here I have P at R 50%. At position 4, with 4 relevant documents, I have 50%. This is one of the measures you will compute for the exercise sheet. Average precision. Now we have precision, now we can do average precision. Now you don't look at P at 1, P at 2, but you only look at the relevant at those positions where you have a relevant document. So let me do the same thing again here. So let's say this is the first in Rhyme is Right, this the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth. Let me just say this is the 40th in my result list, and let's look what's relevant here and what not. So this is again relevant. This is it's similar to what I had before. This is relevant. This is also relevant. And this is also relevant. And everything else is not relevant. Let me indicate this with red. Not relevant. So what's P at R1? P at R1, so R1 is the position of the relevant documents. The first relevant document is at position 1, the second one is at position 4, the third one is at position 5, and the fourth one is at position 40. It doesn't matter, I mean, you have to implement this, you have to pay a bit attention, right? It doesn't matter that they occur in that order, right? There is no order among the relevant documents. All 4 are relevant, it doesn't matter. Yeah, so 582, one of the relevant ones should be at the top. So if all 4 occur at the top in any order, you would have 100%. So what's my precision at R1? R1 is 1, so I want P at 1. What's P at 1? Yeah, 100%. So R2 is 4. What's my precision at 4? 50%, yeah. You see, now I'm not considering precision at 2 and precision at 3. I'm only considering precision at where I have a green element. What's my precision here? 60%. And what's my precision at the last relevant document, which is at position 40? 2.5. Any other? Why 2.5? It's at position 40. What is it? It's 10%, it's 4 over 40, right? I have 40 elements here and 4 of them are relevant. And it doesn't matter what's in between, it's 10%. So, you see, things get, I mean, it's easy mathematically, but it quickly becomes a little more complicated when you accumulate this. So the average, and the point is, you want one number in the end. You don't want a lot of numbers. When you want to compare two things, you want one number. How do you get one meaningful number? That's what AP does. Now I take the average of these numbers. So what's the average? Let me just write it down. 100%, plus 50%, plus 60%. And let me just write, of course you can also write 0.6, but percent somehow makes it clearer that it's something between 0 and 100. Divided by 4, that's what you do. And what's the... Don't use a calculator, you can do it in your hand. 55, yeah, that's correct. Yeah, so this would be one number to measure the performance of this query. Yeah? So this query is half good, yeah? Some relevant ones towards the top, there are two irrelevant ones here, also relatively towards the top, and one relevant one relatively further down the list. So this is average precision. And you may wonder, or actually you have to implement this, when a document is not in the result list, you just say the precision at that rank is zero, right? And understand, why is zero a good number? If you have a document which is not in the list, you might as well say it's at position 1 million, right? And then you get a small number divided by 1 million, which is basically zero, right? Not in the list or at a very, at a position very far down, at a very high position, is like precision zero. Yeah, and a document which is at position 1 million is useless, so zero is a good approximation. Now, this was for one query, always for one example query. Now, in a benchmark, we give you this benchmark with 10 queries, you just average over these numbers, right? And because this is already an average over the precision at the various ranks here, you don't call the average over the average average, but you call it mean, right? Which is just a bit confusing, but yeah. So you have several queries now, you're taking the average over all queries, and you call it the mean over all queries. Mean is just a different word for average, right? And it's denoted by a capital M. So MP at K is just the average of all PHK over all queries. You can do it for every measure, and you can also do it for the average precision, right? So mean, average precision, slightly confusing name. It's the average of the averages, yeah? For each query, you're computing an average over all relevant documents, and then you're computing the average over all queries, yeah? These, especially MAP, you will see a lot, yeah? It's the single most commonly used measure, I think, to give one number to how well a search engine performs. And MAP is a good number. Let me just go back to the example, because, yeah, it's not enough that your first result is relevant. It's also important where your last relevant document occurs, right? If you manage to always get the first few as relevant documents, but the last one is way down the list, you won't get a good score. So this AP and the average of those is actually a good, yeah, it captures a lot of things. Okay, any questions so far? So these are relatively easy to implement. Yeah, now a bit more fun, and we will also do it together. So these are very simple measures, but used a lot. Now let's do two more complicated measures, which are also used a lot nowadays. One is discounted, and now the names become way more convoluted. That's very common in information retrieval, just to frighten people, but it's actually very simple what's behind. So here's one aspect. Sometimes relevance comes in more than one shade, yeah? You have some documents which are super relevant, and you just indicate this by a number. You have some documents which are relevant and some which are clearly not relevant, yeah? So you have shades or grades of relevant. And now I want a measure which somehow gives me a higher score if the very relevant ones are at the top. Yeah, that means the very relevant ones should come before the somewhat relevant ones. So this does not yet do this. It does not contain the word discounted. This just sums up the relevance scores, right? This is already a meaningful measure, right? So I have this relevance score, which is 0 for not relevant, 1 somewhat, 2 for very. You can also have more grades. And you just sum them up at the first k positions, yeah? So if you have very relevant ones, this will get higher. Now, you can discount this. Discounting means you give a weight which is higher if it's higher up in the list, right? So for the first relevant, I have the factor of 1. And if it's further down the list, I'm dividing by log 2 of how far down the list I am, right? So I'm actually not giving a higher weight to the top ranks, but I'm giving a lower weight to the ranks further down, right? And I'm not writing divided by I here, that would be a bit too extreme, but by log 2i, right? So I'm just discounting results further down in the list. This is very important for everything that is web search-like, right? You really want to give a lot of importance to the top hit. What occurs at position 20 or 200 is not really important, which is, this factor is taking care of it, yeah? So, now these measures have a problem. They are not between 0 and 1, yeah? They become larger when you have larger results list and so on. So you want to normalize them somehow, and you do that by just computing the best possible value, yeah, which is called the IDCG, and then you just divide by the best possible value. And let's just do that for an example, yeah? So this is a measure which you will also see a lot in the literature. So let's just do this here. Let me make a start. So I want the DCG at 5. Let's assume I have only 3 relevant documents overall. That's important in a second, not yet. So I just take the first document and I just take the 2, and the weight is 1. Now I take this one here, 1, and I divide it by this discount for position 2, which is just log 2, plus I don't take the not relevant ones. The next relevant one is at position 4, and it has a relevance of 2, and I divide it by log 2 of 4. Right? And this is 2 plus, yeah, log 2 of 2 is 1, plus 1. Log 2 of 4 is 2, 2 divided by 2 is 1. You see what's happening here? I have a 2 further down in the list, and it's divided by 2 because it's at position 4, right? If this 2 would have been here, it would have been 2 over 1. I would have had a 2 here. That would have been better, right? So I'm losing something here. That's the discount, right? So this here is the discount. Yeah, that's why it's called discounted. The discount for position 4. So overall I get 4 here. Yeah? And 4 by itself, I don't know what it means. Is it good? Is it bad? It's just some sum of numbers. That's why I need the normalization. So what's, if I have 3 relevant documents, then you tell me what's the best possible outcome of this thing. What would be the optimum? So what's the best possible ranking here and the measure? Any suggestions? 4.5. Okay, so we should, the 3 ones should be at the top, right? So I should have a 2 here, and 4.5, I should have a 2 here, which is now discounted by this, which is just a factor of 1, and then I have the 1 here, right? Yeah, and it seems you are, yeah, that's the best I can do, 2, 2, 1. I can rank it no better, right? So this is now 2 plus 2, no discount here, and now it's 1 over 2. So you're right.
Shouldn't it be like log of 3 for
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Ah, thank you. It should be log of 3. So I made the same mistake which you did. But yeah, exactly. Thank you for paying attention. Great. So what's log 2 of 3? It's that's the same as 1 over log 2 of 3 is, I think, log 3 of 2, right? Log 3 of 2, which doesn't really help us, but so what is it, 0.63? Can someone Google it? Is it true? That's what my calculator said, but maybe I'm wrong. 4.63? What's 1 over log 2 of 3? Can you write a program to Claudius? What do you? Is it correct? 0.63? Hey, you're supposed to help me. Ah, you don't know how to type it into. Okay, so it's log 3 divided by log 2, and then it should be the inverse, right? So log 2 divided by log 3. Yeah, 0.63, that's a very famous number. I was right. So that's the best possible value, and now this normalized thing is just this divided by this, right? So it's just 4 plus this, and now I just divide this by this, and I get 0.86 something. Yeah? So this is just 4 divided by the best possible value, 4.63. Which is 8.6, was it 6? Yeah, 8.6. 0.86, right? Was 86%, right? So again, I get a percentage now, which is more meaningful, right? So this is pretty good, but could have been better, right? This gap here was not so great. This could be one further up, and actually the very relevant one should be before the relevant one. Okay, one more measure, and you have to help me, please. This is also very common. It's called BPREF, yeah? And what is that good for? We gave you relevant judgment for the exercise sheet, and that was already a lot of work. That was 200,000 movies, yeah? And think about it, it's for some queries, James Bond movies, we actually used a knowledge base, right? We have a knowledge base which just lists, or there's a finite number of James Bond movies. And so you can find them, identify them, even without looking at all the documents. But for some queries, it's just infeasible to check all the documents, right? Think of University Freiburg for the whole web, right? All the documents in the web which are somehow connected to University of Freiburg, maybe even with shades of relevance. Nobody can do that, right? If you have 40 billion documents. So what you will have judgments only for a part of the documents, right? Actually, what you use, yeah, there are all these competitions, they are very important for research and very popular also. Now you have a lot of participants, say 100 teams participate, and what they do, and it's on a web corpus, on a very big corpus, so they just take the, say, top 100 results from each participant, or let's say 100. So there are 100 participants, you take the top 100 results from each, you get 10,000 documents, or maybe less because there's some overlap. And now you just judge these 10,000 documents. That's pooling, right? However you do it, you don't have full relevance judgments now, like we had in the examples before, right? So now what do you do? How do you compute a measure? And here is a formula. Yeah, these formulas always look a bit frightening, but we will do it for an example. That's the formula. And let me just skip to the example right away and then go back to the formula. I think it's easier to understand by an example. Let's assume we have this situation. Yeah, we have 7 documents. This is again for a particular query, right? This is always for one query, right? Let me, for a particular query, right? And then you can average it over all queries. You can do that with every measure, right? So, in my result list, my search engine just returned 5 results, right? A search engine usually doesn't return all documents in some order, but just a subset, right? So, my top hit was judged relevant. My second and third hit was not judged. This can happen, right? So, I don't know whether it's good or bad, so I somehow need to incorporate this into my measure. The fourth hit was judged not relevant. The fifth one was judged relevant, and then I have some other judged documents, actually 1 relevant, 3 not relevant, which don't appear in my result list. And now, what score do I compute? Let's look at what bpref does. So it has this set R, which is the set of, let me write it here again, I think. I wrote it on the previous slide, but it's good to have it all on one slide. R is just all the relevant documents. All docs judged relevant. Yeah? So this is here 1, 5, and the 1 not in my result list. All documents judged relevant. The writing does not work properly up here. N is just all documents judged not relevant. Not relevant. Yeah? So, there's just 1 in my result list and 3 not in my result list, right? RR is docs in R and in result list, right? Docs in R and result list. Yeah, so it's a lot of name, but it's actually simple, right? They are just, these are all the ones which are judged relevant in my result list. That's just 1 and 5, right? So, now this NR, let's look at what the NR is. Now let's go back to the formula. NR is just for each relevant, judged relevant document in my list, I just look how many judged non-relevant ones come before it, and I divide it by some normalization. So this is just, I'm looking at all the judged relevant ones and the judged non-relevant ones, and I'm taking the minimum. So let me just write this here. So the minimum of R and N, I'm just looking where there are less. Yeah, R is just 3, and this is just 4, so this is just 3. We will look at the formula again in a second. You will see that this is just a normalization number. So, hit number 1, there are no non-relevant ones before, so this is the best situation, right? So this is 0. 0 divided by 3, which is 0, right? Now let's look at number 5. Number 5 is here, and now I'm just counting how many relevant ones come before it, and I again divide it by 0. So this is 1 over 3 here. This is just the normalization factor which I'm using. It's 1 over 3, right? Or 0.33. Let's just check, this is this number here, right? NR divided by, oh no, the NR was actually without the, I have to correct myself here, that was just the 0 and the 1, yeah? So that was actually, this is just the empty set, and this is actually a set, how I define it, and this is hit number 4. Number 4, yeah, so the number of this thing, NR, hit number 1 is 0, and NR of number 5 is 1, yeah, just 1 before. So now let's do the B-Prev thing. So what I have to do is I'm doing this for all relevant documents. I'm summing this up and then I'm dividing by the number of relevant documents. Let me just do this. So there are three relevant documents, so I'm dividing by three here. And now I'm dividing over all relevant documents. There are just two here. So for the first one, it's 1 minus this 0 divided by this 3. And for the second one, it's 1 minus, and now it's this 1 divided by this 3. I'm sorry. It's not so easy with a broken pen. It will become clear in a second, don't worry. Maybe it's clear already now. And this is, before I compute this, understand what's happening here. So this is for, let me just do this in green here. This is for hit number 1, right? And this is for, the writing does not work in the document. This is for hit number 5. I'm just doing this for all the relevant ones, right? And what I'm doing, if all the relevant ones were at the top, I would just add 1, 1, 1, right? If I have three relevant ones overall, and there are no non-relevant ones come before them, then I would always have a 1 here, like for number 1, and would just add up all my ones, right? So I would have 3 ones here, and then divide by 3, and I would get 100%, right? If all my judged relevant ones are such that no not relevant ones comes before them, right? And now this minus is just some discount if not relevant ones come before them. Here for number 1 I don't have a discount. I get the full 1, right? Because no non-relevant documents comes before. Here I get a discount because 1 not relevant document comes before. But it's just 1, so I just get a small discount, 2 over 3. And my third relevant one is not in my result list, so I get nothing for it, like a 0, right? So I think that explains the intuition pretty well. So it's 1 over 3, and so it's 1 plus 2/3 over 3, which is 4/3. Right? No, that's not 4/3, it's 5/3 over 3. Is that true? Is it 1 over 3? I think it's, yeah? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's 5/9, right? I can, wow, this is annoying, I'm very sorry. I hope we, what's 5/9? 0.55, right? It leaves a trace here. It's really interesting, special effects. 5/9. 1/9 is 0.1111, I think, right? So it should be 55%. Let me write it down here. Writing doesn't work down here. This display is broken. 55.5%. Yeah? Any questions about this? So there are many such measures in information retrieval. These were some of them. So here's the last slide, and let me go back to the exercise sheet. I know you can also ask more questions. Now let me first show you the slide, then the exercise sheet. Overfitting, yeah, this is very important. You're leaving before the important slide? Okay, you have to, you are excused, but let me just wait until you... yeah? You get a benchmark now for the exercise sheet. Let me just show it to you again. That's very important. You really have to learn this. many of you are also interested in machine learning, and it's the exact same thing there, right? So this is not only information retrieval, it's also a machine learning thing. This is your benchmark, yeah? In machine learning, this would be your training or test set or both, right? You can split it to get a test and a training set, which just gives you ground truth, right? For this query, this would be the perfect result. For this query, this would be the perfect result. Yeah, whatever the problem is, this is, you have a ground truth here, which tells you what's correct. Now, you have a competition. We have a small competition for the exercise sheet. You want to get a great result for this set, right? Now, you could, of course, look at this set and just tune your algorithm like crazy, right? And what's an extreme tuning like crazy is just if query equals films about spiders, then result list equals 48585, yeah? This would be one way of extreme overfitting, yeah? You just, and actually, yeah? I mean, this would be an extreme way. Many people would consider that cheating, but if you somehow tune your algorithm, you introduce so many parameters that for this query it does exactly this, for this it does exactly this, then you are doing the same thing, right? And it can happen pretty quickly, also unconsciously, yeah? You're just trying hard until you get great results, yeah? And this is why in a realistic environment you are not given this set on which you will finally test your result. Yeah? You will be given a training set, another set. Yeah? So in a competition, you would be given this set here, and now you can try to get good results, and then the evaluation is done on another set, on a test set. Right? Now that would be too much work for the exercise sheet, which is why you do the training yourself. Right? So I made a slight mistake explaining this like 45 minutes ago. You tune your search engine on queries which you think of, right? You don't look at this set yet, yeah? This is for later. This is just for testing. For training, you just try to make it as good as you can with queries which you think of yourself. And then you are done. So let me go to the exercise sheet now. Yeah? This tuning phase should be, yeah? Before you go to exercise three, you say, okay, now I have it. This is my search engine with all the tricks I could think of. I think these are the best parameter settings ever. And now you go to exercise three. Now you evaluate it, right? And now you're not allowed to change it anymore. Then it's like conditions like in a real competition, right? I hope that became clear now. Yeah, here it's written again. Yeah, once you started testing your system, of course, you can fix bugs, but you shouldn't tune your parameters anymore. That would be overfitting. Then you are just good on this test set, and on another test set, you will probably be not so good. And how does it work? Well, very easy. We have a result table here. It's a wiki, so you can write it. Yeah, Claudius has entered some baseline results here so that you can, yeah, that's always useful to know. And actually, people will enter their numbers. So you see, oh, this result can be achieved, right? So you see, it's not great numbers, but you will also see that it's not so easy to beat them. Map is hard. Yeah, you, principle, you could get 100%, but it's very hard. Yeah, so try to beat it, and then you just enter a row here with your result. And here you just write very briefly which tricks you implemented. Okay, that's it from my side for today. We have 2 minutes left for any questions you might have. So you have 2 weeks for this. Let me, this is what I wanted to show. Yeah, no lecture next week, so November 7th, that's 2 weeks. Yeah, this is a bit more work. Don't start only in 1 week. Yeah, you should start thinking about it and already doing some implementation this week. Any questions? Yeah?
In the method you wrote last lecture,
yeah?
There you check about if...
Which one? So let's go to the... we're talking about the code from last lecture. Here it is. Back row, can you read this or is it too small? You can't read this? Can you hear me? No, you didn't. You want it bigger? Like this, better? Better? Eye doctor, the eye doctor. Your question, please. Yeah? Here, in line 35, you're talking about this line. This is a hash map now, right?
Is it a problem for the linear time complexity?
The question is if this is a problem for the linear time complexity, because it was on one of my slides. If this would be an array, this would be a problem, right? But this is a hash map, right? Ah. A dictionary. So now, I had it on the slide of lecture one, the inverted index is a hash map from words, or a map from words to lists, right? So this is just a lookup of a key in a dictionary. And you can implement a dictionary such that this works in O of one time. Whether Python does it in O of one time, constant time, is a different story. But in principle, that's an efficient operation. That's a good question. Are there any other questions about anything? You were just stretching? Yeah, it was a long a long journey. Any other questions?
Can we actually use multiple Python files and then load the imports or something, or do we have to grab everything into one file? I'm not really sure about that.
Okay, that's a good question. Can you use multiple Python files? Yes, you can, if you think it's helping the modularity or overview. I wouldn't use too many, but yes, you can. Let me address one other question, which was asked on the forum. Can you import other stuff? I mean, you can import standard stuff like regular expressions or so on. You don't need any libraries, right? Except later linear algebra stuff in the later lectures. But you don't need any sophisticated libraries. If you do, you're probably wrong. If you think you're right, ask on the forum and discuss with us. You have to convince us. But usually you don't need any advanced stuff, right? The point of this lecture is that you do everything from the bottom up yourself so that you understand what's happening and what you're doing. And you saw that already with building inconspicuous built-in functions, you can do tragic mistakes which cause quadratic runtime and whatever. Any other question? Okay, so have fun with the sheet and see you in 2 weeks. Bye bye.